Hello everybody, here we are at Team Dynamics on a very cold January morning 2025. Tom Ingram, Daniel Welling, learning all about IT and motorsport. So Tom, today we're here at Team Dynamics.
Yep.
As guests of Excelr8.
Correct, yes.
The team that you drive for. And we're here today to understand a little bit more about how IT is used in a British touring car team.
Yep.
For a professional racing driver. And ultimately, how IT is used during a race weekend live British touring car event.
Perfect, yes.
So, where do we begin?
Where do we begin? So yeah, I mean, so this is Team Dynamics. So we're based just outside of Droitwich. The Team Dynamics and Excelr8 link came about really at the end of the 23 season into 24. So we've been here now, we're filming here just in early 2025. We've been here just over a year now. So this has now been a joint venture effectively between Excelr8 and Team Dynamics to sort of base us out of here. Which has been fantastic for us because it's meant that we're far more centrally based. Before the workshop was based down in Eye in Suffolk, which is a long way from everywhere. So actually now to be far more as a central hub for the UK is great for us. With all British rounds, we're within 2.5 to 3 hours of all races now, which is really good. The facilities are fantastic, from meeting rooms through to workshop space to engineering rooms, which we'll go around and I'll show you around those in a little bit as well. It's a great place to be based. This place was purposely built for this very reason, to run a racing team from. It's not a converted barn. It's not a converted Amazon distribution warehouse. It is a purpose-built motorsport engineering venue for us, and it works perfectly. It's been a great place to be able to base ourselves on.
Fabulous to walk around, albeit a little bit chilly out there.
Yep.
But thankfully, we've got our episode sponsor, MSP Finance Team Beanies, to keep us warm.
Thank you very much indeed. Yep.
Head out.
Yep, absolutely right.
And perhaps let's start off with talking a little bit about the IT that you as a professional racing driver use.
Yep.
Well, yourself and Laura, the driver and commercial management team. How do you use IT day to day?
So a lot of our stuff is all based through IT. Laura and I both are on Macs. As our sort of general office stuff, we're all based through Macs. That is our hub. That is what we do. In terms of what we need day to day, it's fairly simple. As a day to day user, nothing too crazy. We base ourselves off a couple of laptops, office based, general emails, communications. Stuff like that. So a secure server at home and all office based and everything from there. So we're fairly run of the mill, fairly simple for what we do at home. Probably nothing for us as effectively a small business. Mm-hmm. There's two of us that are full time, and some people that help us out remotely. So we're fairly steady with nothing too chaotic, nothing too crazy. Fairly run of the mill, two Macs, secure server at home, and that's about what keeps us going.
Okay, very good. And you mentioned Office, so your
yep.
Outlook for email and calendars.
Correct. Yes. Yep. So everything based through that. We have a we have a company we work with to do all of our website stuff. So that's all controlled through Office Outlook. So obviously emails are all through that. Mm-hmm. I ping them through obviously to my phone. I just use Apple Mail at home and it just for ease. Mm-hmm. But all connected through from there. So yeah, that runs all of the merchandise stuff through Jenna, who's based in just down the road from us, who runs all the merchandising for us. She's got access to all the emails from there. So yeah, like I said, nothing too crazy. Mm-hmm. Fairly the run of the mill stuff, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I guess moving on to the Excelr8 team itself. We've got a lot more IT reliance. Where we've got more users, and of course they're now multi-sites. They've still got their original base in Norfolk.
Correct. Yes.
They're then running a satellite location here at Team Dynamics.
Yep.
And I think, am I right in saying during a race weekend there are about 30 people?
Yes. Yeah, there's a lot of people involved, and we end up kind of looking a little bit in a window. Won't mind me saying it, a bit like a travelling circus in a kind of way, because everything gets effectively packed into a truck, gets taken to race weekend around the country. Might come back here to be unloaded and prepped, but the majority is kind of on the road on the fly a lot of the time. When we get to this time of the year, obviously everything slows down a little bit. Everything becomes a little bit more office-based. So a lot of that on-the-fly remote work that we do tends to stop, and it all tends to sort of be hardwired Ethernet ports that we're from an office. Most of the design will happen here as well. Spencer and a few of the other design and engineers who are based remotely will do the stuff maybe at home and then email or transfer designs and that over. But certainly when we're here, it tends to be a lot more office based. So that you'll see everyone from the Dynamics side, from the Excelr8 side, all kind of sat with computers with sort of multiple screens of either design work going on or general day-to-day email stuff and communication stuff. So it changes by the day, it changes by the week. But for the majority of it, certainly in season, out of season, tends to be quite office-based.
Mm-hmm. And a good distinction to make, whilst you're racing in season, you're out and about, you've got remote working, mobile working to contend with. In the off-season, you're more static, although multiple locations. My understanding is that touring cars is a pretty regimented, limited series in terms of the design that goes on. So what parts of the car are you able to design yourselves, if not assemble yourselves?
Yeah, so off-season tends to be when a lot of that is then is designed and improved upon. Mm-hmm. We're all set within quite a strict level of regulations within the championship. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a 2-litre turbo engine kicking out in the region of about 380, 400 horsepower within that sort of general band. The torque is limited to within a certain amount. The horsepower is limited to within a certain amount. So from an engine parameter side, that's all fairly fixed. There is a lot of development that goes on within that goes on with our engine partners who are based over in Swindon, who are doing dyno work and flow testing and all sorts of other bits and pieces that go on in the off season. And then in terms of the design that we do here, we'll be looking at CFD modeling with intercoolers. We'll be looking at ducting work. That could be anything from keeping the engine cool to keeping the engine warm when it's cold to brake temperatures through to aerodynamics. So a lot of the front bumper design and bonnet design and wing design and that can all get done here. Again, we sit within quite a strict regulation. The British Touring Car Championship has famously been a championship that you can recognise them from road cars. It's not how Formula One does, which doesn't have any reference to the look of a road car at all. The BTCC is designed that you can see that car and go, I also drive a Hyundai i30N fastback on the road as well. And there has to have some looks and familiarity. So we have up to the 300 millimeter line. So from, imagine holding a steel rule from the floor up to 300 millimeters, up, you know, to that band, we're fairly free to a certain degree to be able to do what we want in terms of trying to improve either airflow, drag, downforce, cooling, whatever it may be. And a lot of that has to be done from October through to April. So it's all fairly high-paced, quick stuff that we have to do, from testing it to proving it to then doing a first model of it, be it 3D printed, be it whatever it may be, and pushed from there. So a lot of CFD work gets done, and a lot of obviously CAD work is getting done here to try and get through some of those challenges. And we're always trying to improve that. Now, the hardest thing that we always find is all marginal gains. We're never going to find anything on the car that we press a button and suddenly find half a second. We may find quarter of a tenth, you know, less than a half of a blink of an eye of improvement. But we need to do that over multiple areas. So if that could be dropping our dropping our charge temps by 1 degree to minimizing drag by half a kilo, and all these little bits and pieces that stack up. So a lot of the work that gets done now is the stuff that can make or break our season to a certain degree. Mm-hmm. So the computer stuff and the design work that gets done here is important, is really, really important to make sure it all works together. So hence why we try to come together as much as we can, because we've got Spencer down the road, we've got Barry down the road, you've got Simon, you know, you've got all these people who are based in different locations, all working on their own projects. And actually at some point we have to then all come together and go through what we've done, what works, what hasn't worked, and then formulate another plan to move forwards. And naturally, and as always is, the contributing factor in all of that is money. That's the biggest thing that you always come up against, because none of this costs, you know, none of this is free. Although we own software and we own licenses, mm-hmm. actually producing this stuff is tens of thousands of pounds. Mm-hmm. So the wall that you always then face, you come against it, is money. Not necessarily time, not necessarily brain power. We have all of that. It's the finances that the biggest sort of roadblock in the way of doing that.
Mm-hmm. And I guess as with any project, you've got to define what your resources are available, what your objectives are, and what timeline you've got to deliver.
Exactly that.
And it sounds like there's a lot of collaboration that's happening. So I imagine lots of video calls and sharing files. And screens. And
the other thing is where does it ever stop? Because with development, we know that development never stops. Mm-hmm. So just because we've improved it by 2%, let's say we've improved our cooling package by 2%, mm-hmm. that means we could do it by 3%. Mm-hmm. So although you say at some point you have to stop, mm-hmm. and say, right, that's all we can do in our budget, mm-hmm. our time, mm-hmm. our availability, mm-hmm. our knowledge, whatever it may be, that's where it has to stop. Mm-hmm. And that's where it's then very difficult to budget. Because if you budgeted £100,000 for that work, mm-hmm. and you improved it by 2%, you went, well, if we did another £25,000, potentially that could do another 0.5% or 1%. Mm-hmm. That's then the difficulty that you come with it. With developing of anything, that doesn't matter if it's software, it doesn't mm-hmm. matter if it's hardware, yeah. It doesn't matter if it's a race car, mm-hmm. if it's a bicycle helmet, if it's the conductivity or whatever of a coffee, whatever it might be, if you can always improve it, you'll always try to improve it. We're in the business of going faster. We're in the business of going around corners faster and down the straights quicker. So mm-hmm. if we can find it, we'll always do it.
That puts me in mind of, I think it was Jackie Stewart that said the objective of motorsport was to win the race in the slowest possible time. and that being the case, I guess there is a balance there always between what you spend and how fast you go and what you can. And as we've seen in Formula One, the introduction of budget caps to try and hold back the unlimited spending.
Yeah.
Would just create a divide, and yep. I think that in particular in touring cars, one of the key attributes that I think that we all like and enjoy is how close the racing is, and that's because the cars can only be developed.
There's only so much that we can do. Exactly that. You know, we're at mercy. That's not to say we could have a new team that comes in who decides to spend £10 million, mm-hmm. when actually they would, you know, very quickly leave everybody behind if they had the right brain power and computing power to be able to do all of that, because that's where the next jumps happen. So mm-hmm. our budget cap is fairly open. Mm-hmm. There isn't a budget cap. You could if you wanted to spend £100 million if you really had the desire to do so. Mm-hmm. So actually, by spending £100 million, it's not like they'll be 5 seconds down the road, mm-hmm. but they might be 3/10 or 4/10 down the road, which is enough in the BTCC.
Yeah.
So that's the constant battle that we always mm-hmm. face. And the constant battle that we always face is the fact that somebody will improve next year, mm-hmm. for this year, as I keep saying.
Yeah.
Somebody will take a big step forwards. Hopefully that's us, but that could be BMW. Mm-hmm. It could be the Ford team. It could be the Toyota team. It could be the Vauxhall team. There's enough teams with clever people around who could take a big step forwards. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that always keeps you on your toes, that constant want to improve, the constant want to get better and develop the car more, develop the driver more, whatever it may be to take the next step. But you're constantly trying to push the envelope as much as you can.
And from an IT perspective, I guess we're always looking for competitive advantage. What's the next big thing in IT motorsport that you see coming down the line?
I think it's the analyzation of data and numbers. So be that through machine learning, be that through AI, whatever that may be, that I think will be the next thing that unlocks performance. Now, the difficulty that we face in our business is that it's not, you never have the same conditions, the same outcomes twice. If I were to take a day round, if I said, let's go to Donington Park, and let's go and do a day's testing around Donington Park. Mm-hmm. Every single lap would be slightly different. Mm-hmm. So it's incredibly difficult to use machine learning and to use AI to analyze that when everything has a slight difference. It's not like trying to predict the stock market. It's not trying to predict when the next crash of Bitcoin is gonna come. Mm-hmm. Although Donald Trump might, I don't know, hacking onto another subject there. you could argue that that's a little bit of an easy one to analyze because there's a number in, there's a number out, there's an effect in, there's an effect out. Mm-hmm. Whereas for us, there are so many variables within that, from the very simplest of weather conditions through to tire life, brake life, rubber on circuit, driver input, is the driver getting tired, mm-hmm. how much fuel is in the car. There are so many variables that go within that that we can start to get down and analyze the data. And at some time, this is why we tend to use humans rather than rely on machine learning at the moment, because we can, as a human, we can quantify what they mean a lot easier without having to input that. Mm-hmm. So what is the effects at Donington after five laps around the Donington National Circuit when it's 20 degrees? Well, mm-hmm. we could wish it's 20 degrees at the mm-hmm. moment. What effect does that have on the car? What happens on lap six? What happens on lap seven? That is where then machine learning will help. Mm-hmm. Downstream in a year, in 2 years, in 5 years, in 10 years, hopefully a bit sooner, of assisting us with that to understand the changes that we do need to make. So do we need to make a tire pressure change because the weather conditions have dropped by 1 degree, but actually 4% more rubber has gone down on the circuit? There's so many variables that we need to work on and learn that eventually machine learning will really, really help us with that, I think. That fundamentally will be the next area of big improvement. And we see that with a lot of other sports. You see that with football, how machine learning is helping within that. You see how it's helping with design work, with manufacturing work. The next logical step is to look at improving of performance as well in our sport. That for me will be the next step.
Mm-hmm. So today, really, it's the experience and instinct of people involved that are making the difference in
sport.
Correct. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. The more experience, the more knowledge that we can put within the team, the better we are mm-hmm. at the moment. It tends to be that is the case. Mm-hmm. The better people you could have, the better your team will perform. It's an individual sport game. Mm-hmm. An individual team game.
Yes.
So each individual has to really play the part to make the team work as a whole. Mm-hmm. And that's the fascinating thing to see. I can do my job as a driver, mm-hmm. but if I'm let down by a mechanic, one mechanic who forgot to put fuel in the car, well, actually, mm-hmm. as a team, we don't perform. Mm-hmm. Likewise, if I don't perform as a driver, if we don't perform from a design team, there are so many variables that go within it, mm-hmm. within this sport to make it all work.